place favorably in space. So essentially, the dispersion energy is something which has to do with correlation of electrons' movement. And dispersion energy is the energy which is not recovered by Hartree-Fock theory. To some extent, it is reproduced by DFT, but with little control and little understanding, although it improved slightly in recent years, but can be very well understood in terms of perturbation analysis, which provides symmetry-adapted perturbation theory. Now, why this dispersion energy is so important? And the main answer for that is that basically this is the force which attracts the atom at sufficiently large distance. So normally, atoms wouldn't attract if there were no dispersion interaction. So essentially, atoms are neutral. When atoms are neutral, they so the dispersion is the main driving force which makes them attract. And not only the atoms, but also nonpolar molecules. Of course, this affects very strongly the properties of real gases, of liquids, of molecular crystals. And interestingly enough, actually, this is the, what was discovered in the past 20 years, the dispersion actually is very important in stacking interaction. It's basically if you have two aromatic rings stacked together, then essentially this dispersion energy is the major force which attracts them. So in other words, the DNA helix actually can exist because of dispersion interaction. And actually I was always fond of poetry. And at some point, actually, when in high school I was reading the Faust of Goethe, then it seemed to me that this is something which resembles me a little bit, the force which binds everything together. So how the dispersion can be captured by current quantum chemistry methods? So the easiest way to calculate the interaction energy is supermolecular method. So in which the interaction energy is essentially obtained as the difference between dimer energy and monomer energies. It's very basic concept, right? So whatever method we have, either it's MP2 or Hartree-Fock or couple cluster, we can just subtract the dimer from monomer energies and it always works, always, not always. It's very straightforward application of new methods we derive, basically. However, the main disadvantages of this method are that there is a presence of BSEC, basic set superposition error. So the methods which we use, they must be size consistent. We have the loss of accuracy due to, so because of this, we subtract from each other the energies which are much larger than interaction energy itself. So the interaction energy can be smaller from the dimer energy by orders of magnitude, by like 6 orders of magnitude. And basically this is hard to extract physics from that. But I want to focus more on these disadvantages. It's basically the presence of BSEC, as far as presence of BSEC is concerned. So the special energy saturates very slowly with the basic set size, and it's very important here to remember about that when you use the supermolecular method. In case the method is not size consistent, so the interaction energy cannot, they basically like MRCI, it cannot reproduce even the limit, not mentioning the correct shape of the interaction. And what is important is that these two disadvantages affect mainly the dispersion force. And I would like to also I don't want to go into details regarding DFT and dispersion, but I need to give some recent progress, and not only recent progress. So basically, there exists very well developed theory, symmetry adapted theory, which is based on many body perturbation theory, and it was developed between late 1970s and early 1990s. So this is implemented in a sub package, Delaware sub package, and it's available for everyone. Apart from that, I would like to mention the what comes next. So there was some formulation based on linear response theory by McQueenie and Jastrzębski. So that was in 1984. So also the Warsaw group, since the Mendy-Bady perturbation theory was giving somewhat inaccurate results, then in some cases some methods were developed to account for dispersion more accurately, and this method was based on couple cluster double ansatz. So that was made, that was done in mid-1995. Also, it's worth to mention about time-dependent DFT expansion, which began of era of sub-DFT, essentially. And one of the most accurate formulation of the dispersion for the larger systems than helium, let's say, was performed by Tatiana Korona and Bogumił in 2008. More recently, it's worth to mention that dispersion energy was combined with F12 methods by Michał Przybytek and Konrad Pachowski, Monika Kodrycka, and Wim Klopper group. And finally, it's worth to mention that dispersion and interaction was introduced also for as combined with CAS STF method and generalized valence bonds, which was done in 2019 by Kasia Perna, by Michał Hafka and Michał Przybytek. And as I say, don't want to mention that, but this is very broadly studied topic in context of DFT, to what extent this dispersion is present in it. So this is basically a growing number of citation of which I looked for keywords dispersion plus DFT. I would like to focus now on wave function theory only. So in perturbation theory, in symmetry adapted perturbation theory, actually we have following partitioning of the Hamiltonian, where A and B are two monomers and V is basically the interaction operator. And usually what we start sub from that we assume that we know the solution of the Schrödinger equation for A and B. And we assume that the zero order wave function is the product of the wave function of monomers. If we have the accurate wave function of monomers, then dispersion energy can be calculated by no well-known second order perturbation theory formula. So if someone likes diagrams, then I mean they'll appear here. So then one can let's say think about dispersion as this kind of diagram where we have separation between A and B monomers. We don't have exchange between these two vertices. So to what extent dispersion is present in many-body perturbation theory in couple cluster? In MP2, the dispersion corresponds to the molecules which are described by Hartree-Fock model, which means that the dispersion energy at this level is very poor. So it can be totally wrong, for example, for benzene dimer or for alkali dimers, where it's either strongly overestimated or strongly underestimated. So MP3 actually doesn't improve dispersion by a lot because it's, it still corresponds only to first order according to the intramonomer correlation. So the proper, actually the quite decent dispersion appears only at MP4 level, but it already is quite expensive. So couple cluster single double theory is not complete to the second order of intramonomer correlation, which means that dispersion is not so accurate in this model. The gold standard quantum chemistry methods, they contain the dispersion energy, which is accurate through the second order of intramonomer correlation. And this is actually the method which you should use in order to reproduce decent dispersion. What is one of the most important points at this talk is the connection between monomer properties and dispersion. So this expression for the dispersion energy can be factorized And it turns out that I don't cannot talk about details too much, but if we introduce, so it's essentially, there is connection between dispersion energy and polarization propagator, which is, in other words, linear response function, which can be defined as the difference between perturbed expectation value of perturbed operator and unperturbed operator. And basically, you know, as we know, the simplest case of the polarization propagator is, I mean, if A and B monomers are dipole moments, then of course this is the polarizability. So basically, there exists this connection between dispersion and polarization propagator, which was actually this similar formula was appearing in the literature for many years, but in this very form was given by Roy McQuinney. So essentially, the dispersion can be expressed in terms of product of polarization propagators integrated over imaginary frequencies, over the, for imaginary frequencies, and integrated over from plus to minus infinity, and V are essentially the Coulomb integrals. So there is a large family of methods which uses this expression, and basically today I want to show one more extension of this method for coupled plastic theory. As a matter of fact, Tatiana Corona did quite similar thing, but what was done by her in 2008 was basically the numerical evaluation of this integral with density fitted response function. So here is slightly different, I mean, significantly different, and I will go to that. So I would like to briefly summarize what we know about coupled cluster theory and polarization propagator. So basically, we assume that we solved coupled cluster equations for both monomers. So in other words, these equations are fulfilled, so cluster equations. And by tau, we denote the excitation operators. So in 2005, Robert Moszynski, myself, and Bogumił Jorski, we wrote a paper in which we introduced something which we called time-independent polarization propagator, which is, has some advantages over a well-known linear response function. So this propagator is has good Hermitian symmetry and is explicitly connected, as you can see, because it can be, it's clearly, it can be it can be written as only as a commutator expansion. So Tatiana Corona did a formidable thing, and she developed that theory and efficiently implemented that in MolPro. So I need some more, I need to explain some more notations. So by P, we denote the projection super operator, and the letter here it denotes that it's either A or B monomer. And by omega, which appears in the previous the omega which appears in the here is basically the solution of following equation. So this equation actually already appeared in the very first paper on time-dependent coupled cluster theory of Monkhorst in 1977. And we also need the S operator, which Robert and Bogumił introduced in 1995, which allows for explicit, for which in terms of which it is easy to write the expectation values in terms of coupled cluster theory in explicitly corrected, explicitly connected way. Okay, so the simplest approximation to S, one of these, so S actually can be expressed only by cluster amplitudes, and there exists some quite simple formulas for that. So we also need to introduce the product Fermi vacuum and the we have to introduce the projection operator, which acts in the this kind of on this kind of product Fermi vacuum. And also we have to introduce a kind of new operator, totally new operator, which we will call dispersion operator, in which basically we contract half of the McQueenie formula in a way so that we integrate over the omegas. And why we do it, I try to explain it. So basically, omega operator can be written, of course, in a spectral form, although this is not so easy because the matrix which we have here is not Hermitian, but we can assume that we can cast it in kind of this kind of spectral expansion form. So in terms of we need to have the we assume that we can diagonalize it, that we have eigenvalues omega I, and we have right and left eigenvectors. We will not use this later. It's only used for proof. So then if we analytically integrate omega, then of course in the denominator, then we get rid of the dependence of omega. So that we can basically deduce that the sigma is a solution of following equation in product Hilbert space. So basically, and as I remind you that we also act on the product Fermi vacuum. So basically this equation for sigma operator is quite simple because it's linear in sigma. And basically it's finite, right? So it's like something like something like similar to couple cluster response, static response equation. So omega operator here is the two electron part of intermolecular interaction operator. Okay, so when we introduce omega operator, then it's easy to derive general formula for dispersion, which is like that. And all we need here are couple cluster amplitudes and solution of linear equation. And it can be shown that this is correct. It correctly reproduces sub up to the second order. And it's what is very nice about this formula is that it's transformed. So the easy to define asymptotic expansion of the dispersion energy in terms of response function, since we have response functions. But this is potentially very expensive, so we need to simplify that. And the simplest possibility is to basically truncate sigma operator to only term which is 1-1, which means one excitation on A, one excitation on B. And T is basically, we restrict T to singulars doubles. And it can be shown that S operator in the very simplest case is basically T operator. So with these assumptions, the equation for sigma can be simplified and the expression for dispersion is like that. So sigma can be interpreted diagrammatically as kind of infinite series of diagrams which effectively sum up all these intramonomer correlation contributions. So basically this is our sigma operator and this is the very simple sigma zero operator, which means like this is a Hartree-Fock based dispersion gives that. And here actually we have slightly more complicated expressions, and magenta vertices means that these are T amplitudes of monomers. But here actually we're still missing triples. So basically we need to add manually in the spirit of CCSD parenthesis T, actually we have to add manually some more terms. These terms are basically presented here. So from perturbation analysis, one can derive that this missing expression which warrants the accuracy up to second order of intramonomer correlation is the following. So basically this term corresponds to the Y roughly corresponds to that kind of diagrams. And this is most time-consuming term. Of course, we have orbital expressions here. And now I would like to show some examples. So I implemented it in a MolPro-based SAPT 2012. And what are the tests, actually? Because we test only the dispersion energy. So what we have, actually? We have, of course, the full CI-based SAPT for helium dimer. We can compare it with time-dependent DFT and with Williams method, couple cluster doubles and STCCD. And of course, actually, our benchmark actually should be the, I mean, what we believe is the most accurate. What was proven actually was the most accurate was density fitted couple cluster single double dispersion of Tatiana corona. So we have some results. And yes, the helium dimer, for helium dimer, for helium dimer, actually, our approach, which actually I refer to it as CCPP, although it resembles a little bit Soviet Union, but maybe I have some, I didn't have any better name for that. Essentially, full CI method is actually what is, from Tatiana, PF-CCSD is essentially the same as full CI, but couple cluster theory, it's still slightly deviates from that, but only very tightly. It's slightly, actually it's somewhat better than CCD theory. So couple cluster CCD is slightly smaller than our.
Please explain what this energy is and what are the units.
Okay. What is energy? This is the dispersion energy, and yes, the energy is given in kelvins. As you can see.
Okay, and but what is the what is this energy?
So this is the dispersion energy we are talking about. So this is the interaction energy
distance?
For fixed distance, basically. So this is a benchmark, right? So usually we test the energy dispersion and I mean the corrections we derive on some on. Against full CI, for example, right? So this is the dispersion energy only for fixed distance. And the unit is in Kelvin. It is Kelvin here, which is traditionally for helium. So as you can see, it works pretty well.
We don't hear you anymore, sir. Jacek, are you there? Jacek, we don't hear the speaker. We don't hear you as well. Nie powinien być muted. Weź zrób to pan sobie.
I'm sorry, I had some technical difficulties. I will share my screen.
We lost the connection with you for a few seconds, so please resume.
Yes, of course. Mm-hmm. So I stopped at helium dimer.
Make a full screen. Full screen.
Yes, sure. So did I answer you? Did you hear my answer to the question? What is?
No, it's okay now. Continue.
I told that it's dispersion energy and the unit is Kelvin. I'm testing the dispersion energy by calculating it and comparing with some better model for given distance, right? So this is work for helium dimer. And as you can see, the time hard to focus dispersion is quite poor. And this is dispersion energy, which is essentially equivalent to MP4 method, which is still insignificant. I mean, there is some significant difference between full CI.
Piotr, you have 2 minutes to go.
Okay, I'm finishing. So it's equally good for argon and neon case. As you can see, the So this is the benchmark which we consider the best, Tatiana dispersion. And as you can see, again, we are slightly better than the second test, I would say, so far, which is coupled, which is CCD dispersion. For water dimer, for water dimer, actually, we're even better than that, than CCD dispersion. So clearly, actually, in this case, SAPT2 is slightly, probably luckily, very close to the benchmark. But in our case, actually, we are sort of confident that it is not accident. Okay, and I have some more examples. It works very well also for HF dimer and CO water case. I have some more examples, but I will not show them. So conclusions, basically. So we have derived a general equation for dispersion in terms of couple cluster time-independent polarization propagator. This formula is quite simple, I would say, that it needs only linear, cluster amplitudes, and it only needs the solution of some simple linear equation. The theory is potentially exact, but of course we have, we need to have some approximated scheme how to calculate it routinely. But this approximation scheme can be essentially improved. So of course, what would be useful to have is some automated code generator and something like tensor contraction engine for product Fermi vacuum. And also what is interesting is that some kind of byproducts, which are dispersion operators in this case, can be used for other purposes, like for example, for improving the some other sub corrections like exchange dispersion, which is which can be easily explained in Hartree-Fock theory. So basically, once we replace sigma zero, then we can improve it slightly. So I think these methods have potential for basically improving subbed method for so that it effectively includes intermonomer correlation to infinity. And of course, we also need a faster code, which makes, which will open, you know, this method for some applications. And this is everything. And thank you for your attention. Sorry for problems with connection, but I'm using Adroam.
Thank you very much, Piotr. Now our microphones are supposed to be switched on, right? And it's time for questions. Are there any questions?
Hi. Do you see any future in implementing your method on a big molecule, especially like chlorophyll, bacterial chlorophyll, or like, you know, biological molecules? Because it become more important optimization of the, such a molecules. And I know that dispersion corrected reactor functions is quite working well for the optimization of the big molecule. And you're saying that you have an exact and more correct and wave function based.
You know, this method is possible to applicable. Well, it can be applied as long as coupled cluster method can be applied for that. So I can imagine, you know, some approximated versions of that so that they can work equally well. I mean, how to say, for bigger systems, if someone wants to you know, introduce some approximation, maybe something like varied composition or less composition. So I think this it can be done somehow, but of course it's not very much competitive compared to DFT, right?
Right.
Okay, thank you, Piotr. The last question.
Hello.
Yeah, thank you.
Is there any question? If not, thank you again, Piotr, for your contribution. And we-